Feminist Creativas presents a word for every generation that knows no fashion.
Greetings. I hope and trust I find you well. I am Elder Mkandla from Solusi University in Zimbabwe, and this particular series for the rest of this week on family togetherness is being aired to you in favor of the Breath of Life SDA Church in the United Kingdom. It is a privilege to share from the Word of God, and above all, to pray with you. Let us spend a moment in prayer before we go into the Word of God. Kind and gracious Father in the heavens above, thank you, dear Lord, for the gift of families. We also pray that you may secure these families and hedge them around so that the evil one may not wreak havoc in them. Many have fallen by the side. Some that are still standing are weak at the foundation. Dear Lord, may you revive the families, both the heterogeneous families, the single-headed families, and the child-headed families. Dear Lord, may you keep us in the safe and hollow of your hand. Be with us now as we go into this study. In Jesus' name we pray and ask, amen, amen. My good friends, just allow me to raise 5 points, but I wish to set the foundation for our course of discussion for the rest of this week on family togetherness. Tomorrow evening, we are not going to have a session, as we're going to have a special guest coming in from the local conference to speak to us. But should you wish to have a devotional in the morning, on the same link, you are going to find some services for you tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. Let us jump into the Word of God. We are at Genesis chapter 1. We want to look at verse 28. The first point we want to draw from here is, what is God's plan and purpose for the family? At point number one, God seeks to establish the sphere of operation for the family, the core dominion that it should have, and the procreation that we have known he entrusted and expected of Adam and Eve. Notice what the Bible says at verse number 28, where Genesis chapter 1, and God blessed them, Adam and Eve. And God said unto them, Adam and Eve. He goes on, number one, be fruitful. Number two, and multiply. Number three, and replenish the earth. Number four, and subdue it. And number five, and have dominion. The Bible goes on to say, over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every little thing that moveth upon the earth. May the good Lord bless the reading of his word as we draw 5 sub-points from just point number one. Notice what God's plan and purpose is for the family before the fall, before the entry of sin. God says to this family, be fruitful. Yes, indeed, we all know the fruit of the womb is a child. God is simply speaking to the biological needs. But as he speaks to the family post the fall, and he says, be fruitful, when so many children have come around, there is still a figurative being fruitful. What does it mean to be fruitful? We want to look at a fruit. What is a fruit? It is the juicy part of a tree. It is the juicy product of a tree that it produces for others and not for itself. So what is the purpose of a family? A family exists for others and not for self. It is not a selfish unit, but it is a unit that seeks to empower, a unit that seeks to invigorate, a unit that seeks to give power to those who are members of it, those who interact with it. That is God's plan and purpose for the family. Point 1b, he says you need to multiply. On multiplication, notice this, addition is incremental, but multiplication is exponential. It goes in all directions. God says, as we come into families, it is imperative that we grow whatever we touch. We grow whatever is responsible and whatever is under our responsibility. To be a family is to multiply, to grow, not only in biological numbers, not only in adding to the populational statistics, but even grow the financial resources that you have. As you started off as a family 5 years ago, compared to today, have you multiplied your financial resources? Look at your physical assets. Have you multiplied them? Are you adding? Are you amassing? That is what God says my plan is for the family. Let us look at how we're going to multiply. Even love towards one another has that multiplied. Point number 1C, you need to replenish. There is a problem where humanity consumes everything and does not replenish. Yes, we go through life as those who are going to consume. We are consumers by nature. But God says, as I am putting you in the Garden of Eden, I expect you to plow back. As I was doing my research, I was told the audience that I'm talking to, there's some who are coming in from the islands. There's some who are coming in from Zimbabwe. There's some who are coming from Africa in general. Some are coming from Poland. As you have made it into the Britain, the Great Britain, you have not made it there on your own. Somebody assisted you to be where you are. You may not be in Britain. Wherever you are, somebody gave something for you to be where you are. It could be towards your education. It could be towards your accommodation. It could be towards your clothing. It could have been towards your food. Somebody gave something you consumed. But having consumed, have you taken time to plow back? Replenish that which you have depleted. Do not be a perennial consumer. Families are places where replenishment shall take place. If you are not replenishing as an individual and as a family unit, then you are not fulfilling the plan and purpose of God. Listen to point number 4. He says, subdue it. What is to subdue? We subdue that which is out of control. We tame that which is rebellious. God is saying, as you are going into the Garden of Eden, you need to establish a position of authority over everything. Subdue these things, tame them, and make sure they are going to bow at your command. They are going to follow your prompting. As we go through life, all that we deal with is helter-skelter. It tends to come off the rail. There is a need for families and individuals who are called by God's name to know and appreciate. They have to subdue things. They have to bring them under their full and total control. And at point number 1E, he says, now you are to have dominion over the whole earth. I want to say, as we build on subduing, notice that he says, over the fish, the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and every living thing that moveth upon the earth. This is something that is being said to them, to Adam and Eve. No dominion is being given by God over Eve to Adam or over Adam to Eve. God gives them dominion over the fish of the sea. Down there where you cannot reach, find ways to have dominion. Up in the air where you will never reach, have dominion over that. And all the things that creep on the earth where you walk, have dominion over them. What is God's plan as he looks into the future of the family? He sees the family having dominion. What is God's purpose as he says, what is the function of this family? He sees a family subduing all things. And he sees a family replenishing, taking care of the environment. What the family consumes, it plows back. And God sees the family multiplying and being selfless and giving fruit. But look at the family, point number 2, post the fall. As soon as we get to Genesis chapter 6, you find that the family has fallen from grace. The family has fallen into a trait of evil. For the Bible says the generation of the times of Noah was continually evil. They dreamt evil, they drank evil, they ate evil, they thought evil, and they were continually evil, breathing evil. As they did so, Noah found favor before God. And what did this mean? Now listen to God's plan. As he looks at this family that he had plans for it pre-fall, now his plans are being set up and they are clear from the get-go. Come with me to the book of Genesis chapter 6. We want to look at verse number 8. The Bible says, but with thee I will establish my covenant, and thou, take not, shalt come into the ark, thou and thy sons and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. God is talking about the family of Noah. As the ark is being built and the invitation is being made for everyone to come into the ark, God's plan from the get-go is to save the family of Noah. God's plan and purpose for your family is to save it out of this kingdom, out of this earth. This earthly kingdom shall not pass to another, for it shall crumble. This earthly kingdom shall come to an end. When it does so, God has a rescue mission. He is taking us out of earth, no more in an ark, but this time we are flying out. And he says, as for you and your wife and your children and their sons, and their children and their spouses, there may be sons-in-law or daughters-in-law, I intend to save all those who are connected to you. This is God's plan for our families. They are a project of salvation. They are a project of purification. They are a project of grace. They are a project of a rescue mission. Point number three, as we move along, notice that as we go further down, the families are becoming bigger and more complicated. Jacob, who later became Israel, has been blessed with 12 children and 12 sons and one lady. Notice this. As Jacob is coming through with these children of his, he then emigrates to Egypt in Africa. While they are in Egypt, we are in Genesis chapter 49, in his old age, as Israel. He now calls upon his 12 sons to bless them. As he blesses them, some he tells them, the scepter shall not depart from your house. For some he tells them, you are not going to amount to much, because you are a man who lacks a backbone. You crept into my what? Into my bed with your own mother. Because of that, you take the shape of the container like water. You need to change, Reuben. This is Jacob as he blesses his children by telling them what shall become of them. Fast forward to the book of Deuteronomy. Now we are in chapter 33. Moses, the leader of Israel, before he lets them go back into Canaan. Remember, when Jacob spoke to them, he was in Egypt, the land of bondage. Now Moses talks to them at the verge of entry into Canaan. And what does Moses do? Moses now blesses these children. Read with me verse number 1 at chapter 33. And he says, and this is the blessing with which Moses, the man of God, blessed the children of Israel before his death. This is before Joshua takes them into the promised land. I love the way God tells us we may be many families. We may have the families of Issachar. We may have the families of Dan. We may have the families of Ephraim. We may have the families of the Levites. We may have the families of Judah. We may have the families of Reuben. It does not matter which family you come from. As far as God is concerned, you are blessable. And Moses blesses all the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sees them into the promised land. Before we enter the heavenly promised land, God has made it his purpose. God has planned it that he will bless you beyond measure. No wonder he says in Jeremiah, the verse we all know so well, I know the plans that I have for you. Plans to prosper you and to give you an expected end. Whose expectations? God's expectations. Whose plans are being executed? God's plans. We are going to make it. We'll be blessed as families. We'll be blessed as individuals. Point number 4. Notice this other interesting thing. You may want to think, how do the rest of us connect into this whole spectrum? How do we connect into this maze? We can't find our identity anywhere there, but God has a plan to bless us. Read with me Galatians chapter 3. We want to look at verses 6 and 7. Skip to verse 26 to 27. I want you to take note of this. Listen to verse number 6. Even as Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, know you therefore that they who are of faith are the same as the children of Abraham. The same are the children of Abraham. I repeat, we are part of a family, a bigger family. We need not be connected biologically, but we are connected by faith. When we hold the same faith that was espoused by the heroes of faith in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, we become children of faith. Now skip to verse number 26. For you are the children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. Not the faith in Abraham, but the faith that Abraham held is the faith that we hold. He looked forward to Jesus Christ. We look back to Jesus Christ, and our faith is built on him. For as many, verse 27, of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. We are a family. We live for one another. We are a family of Christ by faith in Jesus Christ. A point number five as we come to an end. Listen to Revelation, the chapter is 21. We look at verse number 12. These families that I've just looked at, the family of the tribes and the family of faith, are represented in the New Jerusalem, are represented in the heavenly gates. These families are in God's plan from creation to redemption. Listen to what the Bible says as we look at verse number 12. It reads as follows, and having a wall great and high, and having 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes, and on the worst three gates. Verse 18. And the 14, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Oh, my dear brothers and sisters, as we come to the end of this presentation, take note. God has planned that the 12 tribes of Israel that came all the way from bondage in Egypt into the promised land of Canaan, they are immortalized. Three of them appear on the east. Three of them have their names on the gates to the west. Three of them have their names on the gates to the north. And three of them have their names on the gates to the south. These families are a subject of memory. Everywhere we go, there is no way we are not going to find the families that have been saved from bondage. Is that your family? God says, I plan to serve you. God says, it is my purpose to serve you so that you may enter through the pearly gates. If you are thinking that heaven is meant just for the children of Israel, take note, those who are children of faith, the 12 apostles, the foundations of this city. For it is a city that is built on faith. Those who seek it, they seek after a city whose builder and maker is God himself. He does not build it on biology. He does not build it on DNA, but he builds it on faith. Do you have faith? As little as a mustard seed, you become a child of this family. Childhood is the DNA of this family. God's plan, God's purpose is to make sure each and every one of us is saved into this kingdom. And he says, that which the Lord has given unto me, I desire to lose none. We are all candidates for salvation as adults, as young people, as toddlers, as infants. We are potential candidates of salvation by faith through Jesus Christ. Permission to pray with you, my dear friends, until we meet again on Tuesday. Let us bow our heads. Kind and gracious Father, in the heavens above, our faith looks up to you. Dear Lord, we know there is a grand plan for our salvation and evacuation from this earth. How we pray, dear Lord, that when you shall come to take those who have loved you and kept all your commandments, we may hear you say, after it is finished, well done, thou good and faithful servant. May you usher us not into the ark of Noah, but into the heavenly kingdom. How we pray, dear Lord, to follow you until they shall ask, who are these? For we shall follow the Lamb whithersoever he shall go. May we learn to follow you while we're still in this earth, as individuals and even as families. This has been our prayer of faith. In Jesus' name, amen.